This lecture is an introduction to mathematical puzzles and games, with a particular emphasis on the kinds of puzzles and games that come up in traditional cultures around the world. A lot of the games that various cultures play are in fact mathematical in nature, and that can happen for a couple of reasons. One kind of reason are games that involve some sort of probability calculations to analyze them, guessing what might happen. This includes both, of course, gambling games and what we refer to as race games. Race games are things where you have some pieces on a board and you're rolling a die or something like that to decide how far ahead the pieces move. Those games necessarily involve the randomness from whatever it is that's playing the role of the dice. And another style of mathematical games are the logic games, those that just involve sort of logical thinking, sort of a pure strategy game. All of the rules are known to us, there's no randomness, we just have to be able to sort of think our way through them. And that concept of analyzing the logic of a particular situation is something that we think of as a mathematical form of thinking. Generally, these puzzles involve having several choices at any stage. We have to select one move from among the various choices. Then we have to pick another move after that, some sequence of moves, and we're trying to achieve some overall goal. And the use of the logic allows us to think through what might happen as a result of one action now, what moves will be available. In other words, how far ahead can we think in terms of the possible choices we will have. There are, of course, certain kinds of combinations of these things. A lot of solitaire card games are like that, where you certainly are working through the logic about thinking where cards might move and stuff like that, but since they often have cards that are hidden, there's some randomness involved. We're trying to take something that's an action that's likely to be good, but since we don't know which cards are face down, we don't really know for sure. There's a randomness involved. We're going to be focusing on these logic puzzles first. These combination games we're not going to really discuss. These tend to be more modern kinds of games. But we'll start off with these logic puzzles, and the techniques that we use in understanding how to process logic puzzles will help us when we get into some of the probability games a bit later. So let's take a look at these logic puzzles, which I also, and more often, will refer to as combinatorial puzzles for reasons that we'll see in a little bit. Mostly because it's all of the combinations of moves that we have to worry about. Now, the thing that makes a puzzle one of these kinds of logic or combinatorial puzzles is that they share certain properties. One is that at each stage in trying to work through the puzzle, we probably have a variety of choices of actions that we can take, and we'll think of those as the moves in the puzzle. In some cases, they are sort of obviously moves, and in other situations, depending on the puzzle, we'll just have to sort of, you know, they're actions, but we'll be thinking of them as if they were moves one step at a time. And when this happens from any particular position, we're assuming here that the moves that are going to be legal are things that can be listed off easily. This sort of prevents the use of trying to hide certain moves or make you have to think through carefully what the rules are, find loopholes in the rules, trying to think outside the box. We're sort of avoiding that kind of puzzle. Some of those can be interesting, but we're interested here primarily in those in which we can just look at a position and essentially write down a list of what all of the legal moves would be in that position. A third characteristic is that the moves that we will make have some kind of predictable effect. We can think through what the result of making this move will be. That's one of the things that sort of rules out the idea of randomness, because before we make the move, we should be able to calculate what's going to happen. And finally, we're assuming here that each move that we make then determines what moves will become available to us at the next stage. That's where the logical thinking allows us to work out a couple of moves ahead of time. Now, there are certain kinds of challenges in these puzzles, problems that are common across them. One is that the combinations of choices over several steps can be pretty huge. So if what I have is a puzzle and there are 10 choices of what I might do, well, we can just sort of try them all. We can, you know, rule number 3 tells us we will be able to figure out what happens when we try each of those 10 moves. So we can just try them all or think our way through them all and decide what the best choice is. But on the other hand, if we have 10 choices for each move and we have like a, you know, a checkmate in 6, some kind of a goal that's going to take us 6 moves to accomplish, well, 10 choices 6 times in a row is 1,000,000 choices, 10 to the power of 6. And that's not something we can sort of just think our way through. So when we have these really kind of massive options here, well, this something of this sort is not what we're going to be working on. We're going to be focusing on things in which there are sort of fewer choices. But this is still the idea that if we have several different choices at several stages, well, there can be an awful lot of combinations that we have to think our way through. And we need, in general, to keep track of all of those combinations. Not if there's 1,000,000, we can't do that. But for smaller puzzles, we'll want to be able to figure out all of the different possible combinations of moves we've tried, which moves we haven't tried. We try one thing, a set of moves. If it doesn't work, we need to be able to figure out what thing to go back and try again that we didn't try the last time through. And as I said before, those first two properties really mean that the puzzle isn't about finding unexpected moves or ways out of the rules, but we are expecting to follow the rules, as they stated. Even when sometimes the puzzles seem kind of, you know, like there should be some other way of solving them. And again, finding the individual moves is easy. As I said, we're expected to be able to just write down a list of them all, but the hard part is finding the correct combination or sequence of moves to get from whatever our starting position is to some sort of final goal. So for example, I assume most people are familiar with the concept of Sudoku puzzles. We're not going to really do anything with these. Sudoku puzzles are a fairly recent invention, but it gives us the idea of these combination things. So if I'm looking at this Sudoku puzzle, then it might be that this cell here, for example, only has 3 possible moves, by which I would mean writing a number in there. There's only, I think, 3 possible numbers we could write in here. We could put in a 2, or a 3, or a 9. Those are the only numbers we could put here. And that, if that were true, if every one of these cells, for example, had exactly 3 possible moves to put in there, well, each one individually doesn't have many choices to think about, but with all of these 54 open cells, that would be a total of 58 septillion combinations of moves to try. And obviously that's not something that we can just sort of think our way through. We will certainly not be running into puzzles that have that many possible solutions, but we will run into some that seem to have an awful lot of possibilities that we have to work through. So one way of dealing with these kinds of puzzles, of solving these kinds of puzzles, is what we refer to as a game tree. So a game tree is a way of keeping track of every possible option that we might have. And that won't work for a Sudoku puzzle, but it will work for a lot of the traditional kinds of puzzles and games that arise in various cultures. Okay? And what I mean by a game tree is that we have a start of a game. This, by the way, is supposed to, this physical appearance here should look like, well, an upside down tree. If you imagine this rotated around, here's the trunk of the tree, and then we have these branches coming off and various other little branches. So I hope you can sort of see that physical picture, even though it's upside down from what a real tree would look like. But the idea here is that we put the start of the game, the starting position at the very top, and then we think about the various moves from here. So for example, in this case, there would be 3 possible moves that I could do as the very first choice in solving my puzzle. That would lead us to positions 1, 2, and 3. And if I had made this move to position 1, and it looks like there, from this game tree, I only have 1 option as to what I would do from there. I would go to some other position. If I started with this move to get to position 2, then the tree is telling me that I have 3 different options as to what I can do from there. 3 different moves from that position. And from position 3, I would have 2 different moves that I could make. So after 2 moves, I would have a total of, in this case, 6 possible different positions that I can get to. But this is the basic idea of a tree. Start here, then put the possible positions that we can get to from there with some sort of move. and then under each one of these, put what positions I can get to from there. Usually these puzzles will have more than two moves, so we're going to continue this tree and think through all of the different kinds of positions we might be able to get to. And again, this doesn't help with the really big puzzles, but with simpler puzzles, this does help track what we've tried and what kinds of positions. You know, we can sort of check them off as we work our way through them and see what moves we haven't tried yet. One of the things I should mention is that when we're doing these kinds of puzzles, a lot of times a beginner working on one of them sort of just tries some things, and you're trying to solve something, so you just sort of start making some moves and see if it seems to find an answer. And of course, for the really good puzzles, the challenging ones, just trying a few things isn't going to work. But it's not uncommon then for a puzzle solver to just keep trying over and over and over again. And that's not considered a mathematically appropriate solution to trying to do a puzzle. To make sure that we have mathematical certainty about some kind of a puzzle that we're trying to solve, we don't want to just sort of try lots and lots of moves until we get tired and get exhausted and say, there can't be anything. We want to have some way of knowing for sure that there really isn't a solution, or else a way of systematically going about and finding the solution that we might be looking for. Let's look at a simple example. This is a simplified form of a puzzle from 15th century Europe, and we'll see the actual puzzle a little bit later. But this is a simplified form, so we can see what one of these trees might look like. This is a form of a three mugs puzzle, and what I mean by that, I have some big beer mugs or steins here, and I have three of them, and one of them holds four cups of wine, one holds three cups, and the third one is a small one and only holds one cup of wine. And right now, I'm assuming that my four-cup mug is completely filled with wine, and the other two are both empty. And we have two people here, and they would like to share the wine, so we would like to divide this up evenly between the two friends. Okay? And what we're allowed to do here is to pour stuff from one mug into another. We're assuming that no wine will spill out of it, so I can pour from the big mug into some of the smaller mugs. And when we do that, we have to really continue pouring until one mug is full, the one that we're pouring into is full, or the one that we're pouring out of is empty. So in other words, you're not allowed, for example, to sort of estimate, to say, well, I have this big four mug thing and I'll pour it out and I'll look at it and see that it seems to be about half full. That sort of answer isn't acceptable, and we can assume that the mugs might be funny shaped, so it's hard to tell when it's half full and half empty. So that's basically our rule. Okay? We can pour back and forth from one mug to another as we go. And our starting position here, so here I'm going to keep track, because if I'm going to make a tree, I have to be able to keep track of what kinds of positions I'm in. So here's my four mug that currently has four cups of water in it. Here's my three cup mug that currently has nothing in it. And my one cup mug that currently has nothing in it. And so now we begin to make some moves from there. And if you think about it, there's not very many options here in terms of what I can do with my first move. One is that I could take this mug and proceed to pour into the small one. Now, if I do that, I can't stop partway through. I have to wait until this is completely filled. And so when that gets completely filled, I will have one cup in here. There will be three cups left here, and this one, of course, would still be empty. And my second possible move is that instead of pouring it into here, I could pour from the large mug into the medium-sized one. And I would end up with three cups here, nothing over here, and one cup remaining in the big mug. So now to set that up as a tree, we'll do it like this. So here's my 400, and here's, and notice the arrows, by the way, are sort of recording where I made my move. So this arrow is saying that I poured from the four cup mug into the one cup mug. This arrow is showing that I poured from the four cup mug into the three cup mug. And then these numbers here, of course, are recording how much wine is in each of the mugs at that stage. Okay, so the numbers record the wine after the move. You can sort of see it, you know, top to bottom. I started off here, I made this move, then I got to this position. Okay, And generally, when we're looking at any sort of puzzle of this form, any kind of logic combinatorial puzzle, to do this, we have to find some way to store all the information about what we call the state of the game, the current situation, what it looks like, what information do we need to know about it. There's some things about this about the actual mugs we don't need to know. All that's really important is this abstraction of how much is in each of them. But for any puzzle, we have to find some way of doing that. One of the things that can be sometimes challenging is we would like to not have to keep too much information around, because making one of these trees, we may have to make lots of these little pictures. So we would like to keep it as sort of compressed or as simple as possible, but no simpler than that, because we need to keep all of the information around. Now in this case, because this is pretty constant, I'm assuming that we always have the mugs in that order, so I don't actually need to keep that information around. So if I make a bigger tree here, I'm going to stop doing that, because that's consistent all the way. I might put it once here at the very top, but I won't bother to put that information later, because we would like to be able to keep as simple as possible whatever we have to write down for each one of these positions in our game tree. Okay? So let's continue to a second move. So here are all the possibilities after two moves. So from here, think through what our options are. If I'm in this position that I got to from this arrow, I have three cups left here. I could pour them into this one, but again, I'm going to have to pour them all, so that would fill this one up. I can't pour into this one because it's filled. What else could I do? I obviously can't pour anything from here to anything. I could pour from this into here, from the small into the medium, which would give me this position. I could, of course, legally pour from this one back into this one, but that just returns me to the situation I was in before. And so while that's a legal move, it's generally a stupid move. And we don't bother to sort of record that. We already know what's possible from there. So this is sort of an important adjustment to thinking about all possible moves. In general, we do not waste our time writing down moves that take us to a position we've been at before. Okay. Looking over here, from here, what might I do? If I started from here, well, I can't pour into this mug because this one is filled already, so I could pour it over to here, which would give me 0, 3, and 1. Now, this, of course, is exactly the same picture as this. So here are two different ways of getting to this situation. We might be interested in both of them if we were really thinking about all possible ways of solving this puzzle, for example. And if this could lead to some solution, then we would have one solution that might come through here and do something, and another solution that would come through here and do something. So we might be interested in keeping track of that. Depending on what our goals were, there are other times when we might want to sort of consolidate them and just say, well, look, that's a position I can get to in two moves. So let's just combine them together. I won't do that right now because I'm trying to stick with the idea of a tree. And when we have trees, branches don't grow back together. So this and this can't come back together. But this idea will become important to us as we get into some of the other puzzles where we want to make sure we don't have too much duplication of effort. Okay? And then, of course, the other possibility, I talked about pouring from here. I could pour from here. Again, if I poured this way, I would be back to the position I had before. If I poured this way, I would only pour in one cup here, and then I would be left with two cups, as I have here. Okay? So this shows us all of the positions possible after two moves. And as I said before, we're going to ignore those moves that take us to a position higher up in the tree. Now, usually we would then go on to look at all of the possible positions after three moves and stuff. I've more or less run out of space here, and I'm close to the demonstrating what I wanted to do. So I'm just going to show the winning move here. So this is the only one I'm going to show from a three-move position. I pour from the one cup back into the four cup, and now I have solved my puzzle. One person can have those two cups of wine, the other person can have these two cups of wine. And this was a solution that took 1, 2, 3 pourings. If I were interested in how many different ways of solving this there were, or something like that, I might continue trying some of the rest of this tree, and I'll leave that as an exercise to the listener if you want to try that. But I have found one solution that took me three steps, and any other solution that continues from here is going to take me at least three steps, and almost certainly more than that. But that gives us, I hope, an idea of what I mean by these game trees and the way we use them to solve these puzzles. Now, I want to immediately cut back and talk about this from an ethnomathematics standpoint. So far, everything I've said has been really just from kind of the math viewpoint of how we solve these sorts of puzzles. In many cases, though, these game trees capture the thought processes of trying to think our way through what the different options might be. Usually, in most cases non-mathematician, somebody who doesn't do game trees, they'll think through all of these things, and there's some conceptual idea of thinking through the different possible ways before you just sort of go about them. So at some level, these game trees are kind of modeling what people themselves in trying to solve a puzzle might be doing, but it's doing it in a more formal way than probably the original cultures would have done. But it does give us some information. It gives us a way to understand the complexity of the puzzles that these cultures created for themselves. We can compare the complexity of different puzzles. So if we see a couple of different ones from different cultures, or multiple puzzles from the same culture, we can sort of compare them across and see how challenging some of them are in a fairly objective form as opposed to just playing through them. So this is a way of kind of modeling what they're doing, modeling the mathematical thinking, because that if they're doing a process like this, thinking through, logically analyzing, figuring out what the consequences of a move will be, that is a form of mathematical thinking, and so we're modeling that, but also giving us some idea of how to understand the puzzles that they've set for themselves. One of the other things that happens is that in many situations, we can kind of quickly see certain properties of the game or the puzzle that experts who did not use these kinds of techniques might have taken a lot longer to sort of understand. In some of the games that we'll see later, it's believable that what we can model in a fairly simple form here is something that a person actually playing that game might have taken years to sort of fully understand and be able to take advantage of. Okay. Well, there are some specific kinds of goals in addition to just this understanding of what's going on and comparing the complexity. As we create these game trees, there are certain things we want to keep in mind. One of the things is that we're using these specifically to keep track of all of the possible options that we might have available to us. We want to be able, if we've made some kind of a mistake, we want to have a record of it so we can go back and check to see if we actually make that move right, check to see if there were some moves that we might have missed or something like that. If we've just been kind of playing the game, trying lots of things, we won't be able to do this. But if we've been keeping track of a game tree as we try things, then it's likely that we will be able to go back and find some missing things. And of course, once we've constructed the entire game tree, we hope that we'll be able to tell things like, there is no way to solve the puzzle. And occasionally there are puzzles with there is just no solution to them. And it's sort of interesting to contemplate why somebody would construct a puzzle of that form. We'll run across at least one that way. Well, a couple. Sometimes we'll find that there is exactly one way to solve a puzzle. And that's often one of the best kinds of puzzles. Those are usually the ones that are the hardest to solve. If there's lots of ways of solving a puzzle, then usually you could accidentally run across one of them. So we might find that there's only one way to do it. We might, of course, find that there are two or more different ways of doing it. The other thing from a game tree is that we might be able to find a shorter solution than one that we found by just sort of trying, just by sort of playing the puzzle for a while. So those, if we construct the game tree itself, especially in the fashion that I just showed, we will always be guaranteed that we find the shortest possible solution to the problem. Okay. One of the finally, one of the things we'll be able to tell is sometimes when you're doing a puzzle, you sort of, you know, we're pouring in the cups thing, we're pouring from one into another, and then we're trying to move things around, and we're pouring back, and we end up sort of getting into certain cycles. We're back to the same position we were in, but we don't sort of notice it, so we just kind of keep pouring, and we can end up getting into this infinite process of just more or less, we keep getting to the same position over and over again. But when we're constructing these game trees as we go, we'll be able to see that, oh, this position is exactly the same as something that we had earlier on the tree, so we'll ignore a move that does that and only look for the better ones. And of course, finally, we will be able to show you our work. So if we're trying to solve this puzzle and then we have solved it and others have not, we want to be able to show them how we did it. We don't want to just say, oh yeah, I solved that. Well, how? Well, I don't remember, okay? And of course, for classwork, it's important to be able to show your work well enough that that I can understand how you went about doing the work. Okay. Now, one little thing in the construction of trees, of game trees, there are two fundamentally different ways of constructing game trees. One, what's kind of the most natural thing for somebody who's just sort of trying to solve puzzles is what we refer to as a depth-first search. So we try some particular way to solve a puzzle, and we follow one sequence of moves as far as possible, and then maybe we realize we ran into a dead end, and so then we sort of back up and try and start over again from someplace. And the other possibility is what we refer to as a breadth-first search. And here, instead of just trying to follow one particular sequence, we look, as I did with the previous one, we try and find every result of what would happen after one move. Then we try to find every possible result of what happens after two moves, after three moves, etc. Okay? So if, for example, here's the tree that I had earlier as a very simple example of this. So if this is what the final tree is going to be, how do we discover this? We're sort of playing the game, trying the puzzle, keeping track of what we've done. Well, we're going to have to start with just the start of the game, and then we're going to proceed to fill in certain things as we discover them. And the order here is the difference between that depth-first search. So if I'm building a depth-first search, what happens is I try something, and then I see, well, let's try that. Okay? And then if this was a dead end, I would then sort of back up, hoping that I can remember where I had just been, sort of undo that move, and then try something different from there. And if this was still a dead end, I would back up and look for another move from here. And then if everything was a dead end, I'd back up to the start of the game and try over again. That's the idea of the depth-first search. On the other hand, when I'm trying to build a breadth-first search, I start the game and I try and figure out what all of the different moves are. And in some cases, we actually fill in what this position is, but it might just be that we sort of make three little arrows to keep track of the fact that there were three different possible moves. We might not actually have written down what those three positions are. If they were simple enough, we might have. Either way. And then we go through and we look at each one of them and try and pull out what their next position is. So I would then put in all of the second level moves, all of the things I can get to from here, all the things I can get to from here, all the things I can get to from here. There's not necessarily always an advantage to one over the other, but one of the advantages that does happen is that when we build a breadth-first search, we're guaranteed that we find the shortest solution because we've found all positions we can get into after one move, after two moves, after three moves. And so if there is a solution that only takes three moves, are guaranteed to find it. And we won't have to have gone off, you know, this might have taken us a long, long trip before we found a dead end and had to work our way all the way back or something. So if you want to, the listener can go out and try some of these mugs puzzles, and here's some exercises. I gave part of the tree, so you can try and fill out the tree, the breadth-first tree, I recommend. If you're doing that, again, make sure that you watch out that we don't add any position that duplicates something higher up on the tree, in the same branches of that tree, so that you don't get into any sort of infinite loops cycling around forever. And then try and answer this question about what is the second shortest solution to that puzzle. So we found the shortest solution before. Well, you can try and look to see what is the second shortest solution to that particular puzzle. And here's another one. So this is the cultural example, sort of a simple one. This was the original puzzle that comes from a 15th century European book. And that is, instead of the 4-3-1 mugs, we're going to have 7-5-3. So these, we have some mugs here that hold some pretty big amounts of wine. So they hold 7 cups, 5 cups, and 3 cups respectively. And we start off with the 5 and the 3 cup mug being filled. So that's a total of 8 cups worth in those two. And now what we would like to do is to follow those exact same rules and to divide the wine evenly so that by the time we're done we have 4 cups in the 7 cup one and 4 in the 5 cup mug. So there is a puzzle along these lines that becomes a good exercise to see if you understand this idea. But I'm going to go on to another example. So this is the game of Tchuka Ruma, which is one of the games from the Mancala class of games. In the Mancala class of games, we have some bins, and we have some seeds, and we do what we refer to as sowing them around. So I would pick up these two seeds, and then I might put one here, and then put the second one here, and then kind of continue, depending on exactly what the rules are for a particular situation. There are many, many different variations of Mancalas, and they all vary in terms of exactly what rules we have to follow. But for Tchuka Ruma, the setup that we're going to use is that there's n bins. In this case, we have 4 bins, 1, 2, 3, 4, because we're not counting the Ruma. The big one here at the end, where we're going to try and get all of our seeds into, is not counted in that number n. And we're going to start with k seeds in each bin. In this picture, there's 2 seeds in each of the 4 bins. And now our rules are that you can start from any bin that you want. So if I started from this bin, I would pick up those 2 seeds, and then we never pick up the seeds in the Ruma because that's where we're trying to get them all. And then when we sow them to the right, this is that the agricultural aspect of I put 1 seed in here and I put 1 seed in here, as if we were planting seeds, and 1 seed in a spot is enough. And so that's the sowing process. And if we have a bunch of seeds, then we always wrap it back to the left. So if I picked up these 2 seeds, I would put one of them in the Ruma, and then the other one I would wrap back to the beginning and put it into this bin here. Okay? And then the rule here, this is the primary rule, is what happens with that last seed that we picked up. So, so if I put it into an empty bin, so let's let me actually get a couple of these rules up here. Okay, if our last seed goes into an empty bin, then the game will be over. And if it goes into the Ruma, that's the big hole over here, then we can start again wherever we wanted to. And the third rule is that if it goes into any other place, then we will pick up those seeds and start again. So for example, let's imagine that I pick up these 2 seeds. So I want to mark those here, if I can. So I pick up these 2 seeds. That's where I picked them from. So that's now empty. I put 1 seed here, and then the second seed here. Well, rule C now applies. So I pick all 3 of those seeds up, and I put one of them here, and a second one here, and a third one here. But this one was now empty, so that was an empty bin, and my game is now over. And wasn't very successful. What we would like to be able to do is to get all of the seeds in here, and I managed to get a grand total of 1 of them in from that approach. On the other hand, if I had picked these 2 seeds up, then I could pick up those 2 seeds. I would put one of them here and the second one here. So at that stage now, that's rule B, is the last seed went into the Ruma. So now I get to start over from any place that I want. So I can, now I have 3 choices. This is the multiplication, the combinations of choices. So the last seed went in here, so my next move I can start by going from here, or from here, or from here. Okay. Remember, when I had done it from here before, I picked up those 2 seeds, 1 went here and 1 went here, I had no choices, no options whatsoever. The rules required me to pick all 3 of those up from this bin, and then proceed to play them out. So this is, every time you hit rule B, that's when you get one of those combinations of choices. We now have generally multiple choices to do at that point. And again, the basic idea is that if all of the seeds end up in the Ruma, then we have won the game. And that's sort of our goal for something like this. Okay? So, let's do a nice sort of reasonably simple example. So I'm going to do three bins and two seeds in each bin. And as it turns out, this game is not winnable. It's not possible to get all of the seeds into the Ruma. But we can still ask the question of how many seeds could we get in the Ruma. This is a nice example because the tree is reasonably small, but still gives me some variation in it. Okay? So as with our mugs problem, we have to sort of decide how we represent a state, which is some configuration of the puzzle as we go through trying to solve the puzzle, and how do we represent a move going from one place to another. Okay? And so here's an example of the game tree. This is a nice natural way to do this, and this is the way that I require my students to show their answers as we go through this. So here is my initial configuration. Remember, I had three bins, not counting the Ruma. If I wanted to, I could make this one bigger, but it seems easiest when drawing them just to make them all the same size. And I start off with two seeds in every bin, except for this. And here, you'll notice, it doesn't really matter here where the arrow goes, but it's starting from this two, and that to us means that we're going to pick up those two seeds and play them around and see what happens. Okay? And so this arrow will take me over here, and when I play those two, I pick those two seeds up, so this is now zero, and then I put a third one here and here. I underline this to emphasize that that's the place where the last seed landed. So what's important in many of these cases is not just what the numbers are here, but where did the last seed go? So that's part of the state of the puzzle, is where did that last seed go? And in this case, my move is forced. So I must pick all three of them up. That's why I sort of have these all connected together. This is like a chaining of events. This is the first portion of the move, but I now need to pick those three up and put one here, and another one here, and then the third one here. Now this is underlined because that's where the last seed landed. And again, I'm forced to pick those up and go one, two, three, and the last seed goes here. And because the last seed landed in an empty bin, that's rule A, my game is now over. I managed to get two seeds into the Ruma, two seeds out of six. Not a particularly good score. Okay. But now, of course, if we were just sort of playing through, we could have just, you know, with our board, just sort of played these seeds through and just put in what the final answer was. But usually, if we want to check our work or find where we made a mistake or something like that, it really is kind of useful to have this little extra information in. If we were trying to go for absolutely minimal amounts of information, we would just put in this last row. But to try and find where we've made mistakes, or in my case, to give partial credit to an answer, I want to see all of these individual steps. And it helps to demonstrate to make sure that you understand what's going on. Okay. Now, let's look at another move. So this one started, the arrow starts here, which means that I picked up those two seeds. This arrow is starting here, so it means I picked up these two seeds. And where did they go? Well, they went to this bin to make three and then into the Ruma. So rule two now says I can pick anything that I want. Well, obviously I can't pick here. There's nothing there to move. But now I have two moves. I can either pick from here or from here. And if I picked up these two seeds from here, I would go one into the second bin, one into the third bin. Now I have four seeds. I have to pick them up. And I go put a second one here, and one here, and the third one here, and the fourth one here. And again, I ended up in a bin all by itself. You can see it's underlined. That's where the last seed landed. It landed in a bin that had been empty, so that move is now over. Okay. Going from here, it ends even faster. I pick those three seeds up, and I go one here, the second one here, the third one goes here. Game is all over because there was only one seed there. And the final possibility is that I picked up those two seeds. One, the first one went into the Ruma, and the second one landed here. And then I picked up those three seeds and went one, two, three. I have two seeds here, but this is where the last seed landed in the Ruma. So again, I'm allowed to start from any other place, except starting from the zero doesn't really help much. So I can start from the three. Well, that doesn't last very long. It goes one, two, three, and so that's the singleton. Last seed landed in an empty bin, so that's the end of that game. And then from here, I pick this one up and move it into the Ruma. Again, the last seed landed in the Ruma, so I now have options. In theory, at least, I can pick up from any one of these, but only one of them isn't zero, so only one of them really has any actual move to make. We still separate this with an arrow, though, because this really is a new move. The one move has ended, and now we just start over again, but we only had one choice. But still, we think of this as a new move. So we indicate it this way. Pick up those three. One, two, three. Now the game is over. But here I managed to get four seeds out of the six into the Ruma. So that's not too bad. And as this tree shows, that's the best you could possibly do, because we now have encoded here on the screen every possible game that you could do with this particular form of Tchuka Ruma. So I hope that helps understand some of these ideas of the game trees. Both the general attitude of how we produce these game trees, the general approaches, but also some of the specific notation that I ask students to use for the mug puzzle and for the Tchuka Ruma puzzle. And as we'll see, we have to come up, for each different kind of puzzle, we sort of have to come up with a slightly different way of figuring out how we represent that information that keeps it as simple as possible, but still remembers all of the information about it. So here's a couple of exercises, again, that the listener can try on their own. Analyze the game with two bins and four seeds in each bin. This, by the way, is winnable. So you should try and see if there's a way, if you can find how to win it, and be able to construct the full tree for that. Analyze the game with two bins and five seeds in each bin, also a winnable configuration. Try it with four bins and two seeds in each. This seems to be the form of the game that has been reported as being the one that they actually play in the region, in the place where this comes from. So this is sort of an important one. This is the puzzle that's actually being played. This is winnable, and you should try and see if you can figure out how to win that. Aside from, so those three are all winnable. There's a couple of others that are winnable. If I have three bins and one seed in each bin, it's pretty easy to show that you're going to be able to win that. It's not completely trivial, but you should be able to find an easy solution to that without having to actually construct a tree. So that's a simple one. When we only have one bin, there are never any choices. You just pick the seeds up. You only have one choice ever. And so you play around and see if you land in the Ruma. And if so, you only have one choice at that stage. So this becomes very mechanical. There are no choices involved whatsoever. And so which games are going to win when n equals 1 is really just kind of a number theory question, which numbers work for that. There's no strategy at all. So aside from that, the ones that we've got here, these three, and then these sort of two particular cases, those are really the only winnable games that have fewer than 14 total seeds. There are some games with 14 and 15 seeds. With 14 seeds, two bins, seven seeds in each, or seven bins, two seeds in each. Those are both interesting games, but they're because they have 14 seeds, they do become more complicated game trees than these. And with these other games, you know, we can try and, with any other values of n and k, we can still try and construct a tree to figure out how many seeds you can get into the Ruma, but you won't generally be able to win them. Now, one other little exercise that I'll suggest here, there are a few theorems about when the game can be won and when it cannot be. We don't know a full set of theorems for this, but there are some. So, for example, if we have two bins, then it's possible to prove that you can't win the game if the number of seeds is a power of 3 or 2 times a power of 3 for any particular power of 3. By the way, that includes the power of 3 to the 0, which is 1. So for k equals 1 or k equals 2, it's not winnable. And it also turns out that there's a couple of other weird values. It's not winnable when k is equal to 11, 20, 30, or 168. And we think that those are the only other numbers for which it's not winnable. Those powers and these particular four values, but nobody's actually been able to show that. Although, if you wanted to find another example where it wasn't winnable, you have to go up to more than 100,000. Why anybody would try and play this game with more than 100,000 seeds in each bin would be beyond me. Certainly has no ethnomathematical significance. Might be mathematically fun, but nobody's going to actually play that game. So we have this little formula here, and just to sort of exercise the understanding of that formula, I encourage you to think about when n equals 2, what numbers does that mean can be 1? Those are the ones that are going to be lost. So what other numbers, you know, what numbers don't get counted out by that up through, say, k equals 12? Okay, this is sort of going through what I wanted to say about game trees. We're going to continue this with some slightly more complicated games. So as a cultural example, I want to spend a little more time on some of the background and what we know about the game of Tchuka Ruma and where it comes from, which unfortunately is not as much as we wish we knew. Tchuka Ruma is part of a large family of what are referred to as the Mancala games. These are mostly from Africa, all around Africa, and the African diaspora into, say, North and South America and the Caribbean, and also spread throughout much of Southern Asia, India, the Southeast Asia, and stuff, areas around there into the Pacific Islands. There are more than 800 variations of this game known. As it spreads, it's a very old game, and as it spreads, people, cultures, and areas change the rules a little bit, try things a little bit differently, and so it's just turned into a large number of different kinds of games. Almost all of these are two-person games, except for Tchuka Ruma, pretty much, as I'll mention a little later. Mancala, as a class of games, dates to at least the 7th century Common Era, with hints that it might be substantially older than that. There's some board games around that might have been being used for this, but we're not completely sure. Tchuka Ruma certainly, as I say, descends from this Mancala family of games and is one of only two traditional forms. There's a lot of invented forms that are solitaire versions, and there are certainly lots of reports of people taking the two-person game and just sort of playing it by themselves when they didn't have somebody else to play. But the only traditional forms of Mancala that are solitaire versions are these two games, Tchuka Ruma and Issa Ozin Egbe from Nigeria. And the second game, the game from Nigeria, really is just a mechanical pastime, just moving some things around, sowing the seeds. There's no strategy, there's no puzzle solving involved, you just keep sort of moving the seeds around. In fact, the way that it works is that you play the seeds, you start in a particular initial configuration, and if you play the seeds correctly, after a while you'll get back to exactly the same configuration as you did. So the only sort of game part, puzzle part of it is, did you manage to do that and not make any mistakes and get back to the same position that you started from? So Tchuka Ruma is really pretty special in this sense as a solitaire version of Mancala. Where it comes from, we don't completely know. This is a map of Southeast Asia, and there's the oldest reference that we have to it comes from an 1890 reference, but that doesn't say anything about where it came from. That person either did not know or didn't say anything about it in that particular reference. The oldest one that gives a place to it comes from 1948, and that reference just refers to it as the East Indies. The East Indies is a fairly generic term that can refer to a much larger area than this, but in some sense, in the most restricted sense, East India refers to all of this. So we have what we think of now as Southeast Asia, Cambodia, Thailand, Burma, and then the islands down here of Indonesia, Malaysia, and depending on exactly who's using the term, it also includes the Philippines up here and Papua New Guinea down in this direction. But we're going to sort of focus on this area because this certainly seems to be part of the East Indies that particular reference is referring to. And I'm not going to come back to this map, but I want to make sure I point out a few locations here. So all of this stuff in this sort of yellow-green is all Indonesia. This particular island in Indonesia is referred to as, is named Sumatra. And what we're going to be seeing is the northern part of Sumatra is a very likely candidate for where this game came from. Okay? But also Malaysia. So here we have Malaysia in this sort of light purple that is part of this tip here of this peninsula, but also comes over into here. And again, if it comes from Malaysia, it probably comes from this area. So this is probably where the game comes from, someplace in this region. And I'll talk about a little bit about the evidence that we know for this. So there seems to be a two-person predecessor of this game, at least in terms of these names. So Tchuka and Tchuka. Tchuka is referred to in 1906, and Tchuka in a 1929 reference. Both of those references are referring to some games in northern Sumatra. Now, those are two-person games, but this might easily be connected to or a predecessor of the Tchuka Ruma. One of them uses really exactly the Tchuka Ruma rule. This book talks about four specific forms of this game, one of which uses the Tchuka Ruma rule for ending a turn. You keep going, and you make your turn. If the last seed goes into the Ruma at either end, because there's two players playing it, then that person gets to continue the turn. And if you reach a position which in Tchuka Ruma we would view as a loss, it just means it's the end of your turn, and so now the other person gets to play their game. And one of our Sumatran students here at Beloit College some years ago, back in the 90s, was telling us when we were sort of asking him around about this, and he remembered his grandfather playing a one-row solitaire form of Mancala in Sumatra. His grandfather was of Chinese ancestry, was of Chinese birth, but he had lived in Sumatra most of his life, and it seemed much more likely that he was playing that as a Sumatran game than as a Chinese game. There's not much of a record of those sorts of games in China itself. Now, there's some linguistic evidence that goes along with some of this sort of evidence as well. So the word Ruma, almost the same as this, means house in both Indonesian and Malay, and is used for the seed collection bins in the Mancala games, where, again, you have these two bins on both ends for the two players, and that word is used there for their Mancala games for the same purposes as the Ruma is being used in this game. So again, the linguistic background of this would seem to imply Indonesia and Malaysia. In northern Sumatra, they do speak a somewhat different language, but Ruma refers to the playing bins that they have in their Mancala game. So linguistically, it probably descends from this word in Indonesian and Malay, but is very likely connected to this word from northern Sumatra. The word Tchuka, so here we have this, we know this word Ruma, the word Tchuka here in Malay, I'm not sure exactly how this would be pronounced differently, Tchuka, I'm not sure in Indonesian, but this word means the vinegar made from the tamarind plant. That seems sort of an odd thing to have as part of this name, but the seed of the tamarind plant is very often used as playing pieces for games of this sort from India. So it seems very likely that those tamarind seeds were also being used in playing this game. So the linguistic evidence here seems pretty substantial that this game is coming from Indonesia, Sumatra, Malaysia, someplace in the region that I circled there on that map that we had. Now, reliable references to this game, as I say, we have not been found, but indications are, like I say, that it comes from this particular area that I had shown on that map before. We have that reference from 1895 to the game, so it seems like it's at least, in that case, 120 years old. Probably not more than 200 years old, or there would have been more record of it in other sorts of sources someplace. It's an example of Mancala being sort of customized by the local people into really quite a different game. And this is something that actually tells us a lot about the game of Mancala, because as it spreads, throughout the world. It changes in very, sometimes in small ways, but sometimes in very large ways. Certainly when it goes from Africa to India, they have dramatically different form of the game in India. And then as it spreads further, this is a dramatically different form of what they played in India as well. But we don't know any real sort of what this means within the culture, because we have not been able to find sort of truly specific references to this in terms of the people playing it or why they played it, whether there was any particular cultural or religious significance to that. One thing that is also interesting, though, is that there is some evidence that this game traveled from that region up to Russia, which seems like kind of a long distance, but there was an extensive spice trade between this area of Southeast Asia up into China and Russia. There's a lot of spices that were being grown in Southeast Asia and in this particular region that were just not available anyplace else. So we do know that there was trade and people going back and forth and materials going back and forth. And there are some reports from 1929 and a fairly extensive one from 1977 that talk about this particular game, not Mancala, but Tchuka Ruma itself, as being spread across Russia and Mongolia and being played widely up there. In fact, some people had suggested this might have been the source as to where the game was founded, and that it started there and then came down into Southeast Asia, but the linguistic evidence is pretty strongly against that. There are no words that people have suggested that would connect a Russian or Mongolian with the name of this game, and yet, as I said, we have pretty strong evidence with the connection to Indonesian and Malaysian and Malay. So this is a little bit of an overview then of what we know about where Tchuka Ruma comes from. So we wish that we knew more, but as I say, we do know that this is an example of the kind of game that certain cultures play that requires some substantial mathematical thinking or logical thinking to sort of work your way through what the possibilities are. And if you have a chance to do the 4-bin, 2-seed version, n equals 4, k equals 2, you'll get a sense of the kind of thinking that they had to do as they were trying to be able to solve that particular puzzle. We'll continue with games on the next lecture.